Good morning everyone. Let's start with a new topic, that is rotator cuff tear. So this is your shoulder complex. I have just removed the scapulae in order to make up the picture perfectly. So this is your rotator cuff. If any tear happens, it will show like this. So the prominent region of the tear of any muscle is your musculotendinous junction, because that is a transition zone wherein your muscle is getting converted to the tendon. That is the definitely weakest part. So definitely rotator cuff being a muscle itself, it is the weakest part is your transition zone again, that is your musculotendinous junction. Second prominent point will be your tendon and third will be your muscle. Coming down to the tear. Rotator cuff tear is common cause of the shoulder pain and disability. Frequency of tear increases with the age and maximum time full thickness tear is generally seen in the youngsters, that is below 40 years. Classification of tear is divided into three types based on duration, that is acute and chronic, whenever the patient is coming down turning to the therapist, based on the thickness, that is partial or complete, based on the size of the tear is given by your post et al. The small is 0 to 1 cm, medium is 1 to 3 cm, large is 3 to 5 cm and massive is greater than 5 cm. We also have one more classification depending on the shape of the tear. The first one is your crescent. Just concentrate on this part. This is where the muscle was full and complete. This was your bone. Second is reverse L, that is the reverse L. The first one is crescent, second one is the reverse L, and the third one is L. The fourth one is trapezoid, and the fifth and last one is massive tear. So this is your massive thickness tear. Factors affecting the post-op rehabilitation. Depending on the tear, usually rotator cuff leading to tear, they are usually undergone the operation. If there is grade 1 tear, then you can manage it conservatively as well. So factors affecting the post-operative rehab, first one is type of repair. What was the type, how operation was done? Whether it is open, mini, open or arthroscopy. Mini, open and arthroscopy do not usually hamper the rehabilitation protocol post-operative. But open, for some days you need to leave the patient as it is, because in order to avoid the stretching of the sutures present in the muscle as well as on the skin. Size of the tear, whether it is the absolute size, that is your total, or the partial, depending on the grades of the tear, that is your grade 1 is 25%, 2 is 50%, and 3 is 75%, or greater than that is your full thickness. And the number of tendons involved, whether it is full thickness or few minor tendons, that is in the quantity. Tissue quality after the operation is good, fair or poor, that is your neurovascular bed. Location of tear, whether it is superior, supero posterior, supero anterior, where is the tear happened, of which muscle, onset of rotator cuff tear and timing of repair. When the tear happened and when the patient came to the OPD or emergency department. Patient variables, that is age, dominant hand, pre-injury level, this is usually seen, it is not peri, it is pre-injury level, this is usually seen, the record is maintained by athlete's coach, and desired function after rehabilitation, whether he wants to practice his sessions daily, or whether he is a recreational player, or whether he is a normal individual. Work situation, whether he has to do heavy lifting, overhead, or just typing work. Compliance with the regime, whether he's going to do the regular exercises at home as well. Rehabilitation situation and surgeon's philosophic approach, that is supervised and unsupervised, is also mandatory checked. Basic rehabilitation of rotator cuff tear involves 8 goals. The first one is to maintain the integrity of rotator cuff. Second one, re-establish full passive range of motion as quickly as possible. Third one is to re-establish dynamic humeral head control by giving the strength to your rotator cuff muscle. Fourth one is improve external rotation muscle strength. Usually the tone and the impinged muscles are your external rotators. So first, before starting with the internal rotation, give external rotation muscular strength. Fifth one, initiate resisted shoulder abduction and flexion when muscular balance is restored. Without restoring the rotator cuff muscular balance, if you initiate shoulder abduction and flexion against resistance, definitely you will get the slippage, that is your dislocation of the humeral head. Sixth one will be caution against the over-aggressive activities. Seventh one, restore patient's functional use of shoulder gradually. Eighth one will be your activate rotator cuff muscle through the inhibition of pain. Examination. In acute tear, usually patient presents with trauma, pain and sudden weakness due to tear, weakness in the shoulder movement depending on which muscle is involved. Initially, passive movement is intact. Gradually, once the tear increases or due to its edema, inflammation stage, fibrosis stage, passive movement becomes very painful. Radiograph traumatic shoulder series is obtained. It should be obtained in the plane of scapulae, lateral view of the plane of scapulae and an axillary lateral view. Radiograph becomes a must as the age progresses because the ratio is increased of the shoulder dislocation as the age progresses. Treatment for acute can be depending on the duration of the injury and condition of the patient. Active patient, acute injury, definite surgical repair. Advantages of early operative repair is early mobility, good quality of tendon is achieved by stable repair, and patients with a rotator cuff tear associated with dislocation, the repair will improve GH joint stability, that is your glenohumeral joint stability. Coming down to chronic tear, duration is greater than 3 months, that is subacute and chronic. Examination, that is muscular weakness and atrophy may be seen in the muscle which is involved and the size of the tear. Passive motion may be maintained here, but in initial acute injury, passive motion is lost. In chronic tear, passive motion may be maintained, but increased chronicity may involve subacromial crepitance and adhesio capsulitis. If not treated, the tear is going to definitely cause the adhesio capsulitis as well. Third point is smooth active motion is definitely diminished in chronic tear. Subacromial injection of lidocaine may help in differentiating weakness that is caused due to nerve as well. Proactive manuals including the Nears impingement test and Hawkins Kennedy test may be positive but not specific, because their positivity is definitely seen in shoulder impingement rather than your rotator cuff. Thus, they are not specific in rotator cuff tear. It is important that the other potential etiologies should be investigated. Patients with cervical radiculopathy C5-C6 lesion, they might as well demonstrate the pain symptoms similar to the rotator cuff tear patients as well. Imaging, a traumatic shoulder series should be obtained which may show proximal humeral migration due to the rotator cuff tear. Plain radiographs are definitely a must because they tend to show degenerative conditions or bone collapse in the patient. MRI to investigate the tear shape, size and degree of retraction of the muscle. Ultrasound and double contrast shoulder arthrogram additionally used to diagnose the tear. Treatment. First point, conservative rehabilitation, that is your physiotherapy. If unresponsive to the conservative rehabilitation or demonstrate an acute tearing of the chronic injury, definitely surgery is a must. Thank you. Let's meet you all in the rehabilitation protocol.